What's up, everyone? My name is K-Rad. I'm a rapper, producer, beer lover, and now I'm a podcaster. Podcasting about Northwest hip-hop and Northwest beer. Why? Well, I love them both, and frankly, you should too. So sit back and crack a cold one as a weekly guest and I talk about all things hip-hop and hops. This is Hoppy on Broadway. Hey everyone, it's K-Rad, and we're about to kick off an interview with G-Funk rapper Speaker Child, but first, I want to apologize for the late release. Due to some unforeseen circumstances, I was unable to edit and record an intro voiceover last Friday and was gone all weekend, so I couldn't finish the podcast. But hey, shit happens, and I'm happy to say I'll be releasing the next episode with Web Wavy online by Friday. And to keep up to date with all things Hoppy on Broadway, please like K-Rad on Facebook, follow on Twitter, and subscribe to the podcast on SoundCloud by searching Hoppy on Broadway. You guys rock, and I want to make sure you're not missing a single episode about the only podcast on Northwest hip-hop and Northwest beer. We're drinking Ninkasi today out of Eugene, Oregon. Ninkasi, if you're listening, your beer kicks ass. Throughout the show, you'll be hearing clips from Speaker Child's latest songs from his album Mind On My Business. Here's the first with his lead single, Mobbin' Since Monday.
I walk in like Christopher Walken's. I put my pants one leg at a time. But when the pants are on, I hit you with a funky rhyme.
Okay, okay, we just waiting on the okay. Okay, we've been mobbing since Monday. Monday, we could probably go for Sunday. Okay, I'm just waiting on the okay. Okay, we've been mobbing since Monday. Monday, we could probably go for Sunday. Sunday, I'm just waiting on the okay.
Sitting down with me to drink Ninkasi Brewing beer is Speaker Child. You might know him from the hip-hop rock group Continental Soldiers or the Skaters and Gangsters Collective, but for the past 2 years, he's been building up his solo career with a handful of singles and a full-length album. Speaker Child, welcome to the show, man.
Thanks for having me.
Did I get all that right in the intro? Is that accurate?
Okay. Yeah.
That's good, man.
Yeah.
Well, I'm glad you're here. Today, we're going to be drinking Ninkasi. I'm going to crack this open in the meantime, but I want to ask
you. This is all Oregon?
This is Oregon.
Okay.
Right? And I know that you're actually originally from California, that's right?
Northern California.
Right.
Lake Tahoe.
So this is just north of that, and then, of course, north of there is Seattle.
Yeah.
But this is a Northwest beer nonetheless.
Nice.
I'm going to pour it out.
What is this one that we have?
This is the Ninkasi Total Domination IPA.
Okay.
It's 6.7% with an IBU of 81, so it's pretty dang bitter. If at any time during the show you want more beer, feel free to crack open the one we're on or a pass one. We don't want to get ahead of ourselves.
Yeah.
But they're here if you want them.
Okay.
So there's no limit. And we even have more in the fridge if you're trying to turn up.
All right. Well, cheers.
So let's taste. Yes. Cheers, my man.
I would kill everyone in this room for a drop of sweet beer.
Mm. What do you think?
That's really good.
Yeah?
Usually IPAs are super strong, but this is smooth.
Yeah. Are you a big beer drinker?
Yeah, I like Pilsner.
Pilsner.
Yeah.
Okay, good. Yeah, and it's not too bad. Yeah, the bitterness is up there, but it's still got a smooth kind of flavor to it.
It does.
Yeah.
I like these cups, too.
Oh, good. It's our tasting cups for the show. Now, like I was saying before, you're from California. You're from Lake Tahoe.
Yeah.
But you started your career more or less in the greater Seattle area. Is that correct?
Speaker Child started in Seattle. Yes.
Okay. But before that, you were with Continental Soldiers, and did they start in California?
Which started in Tahoe, yeah, Lake Tahoe.
Okay, and then at what point did you make the migration from Continental Soldiers to a solo act?
So we ended up becoming a bigger group. It was just two artists.
Right, two MCs.
Yeah.
Okay.
And then we moved up here, and we're like, we got to step up our game. So we got a drummer, kind of did a live thing, got a bass player, guitar player.
Mm-hmm.
But everybody kind of grew up, got married, you know, focused on careers.
Sure.
And I was like, I want to tour. I want to keep playing music. And so I just went for my own thing.
Yeah.
And it's hard to work with the group because it's like having a partnership in a business. Everybody has a different idea, but everyone has a different schedule. So.
Sure. And what do you think the biggest change was from when you moved from your band into a solo act?
Well, it's a different type of music.
Yeah.
So.
Well, because I've listened to Continental Soldiers, and there's definitely a lot of different influences, especially when you guys added in the guitars.
Yeah.
Right? But then I listened to your new stuff, mm-hmm. As just Speaker Child. It's a lot more G-Funk.
Exactly,
based.
Yeah.
And how was that kind of transition for you? Was it like really fun? Were you just open to all these different ideas?
Or so I went back to my roots. Mm-hmm. So that's what I like. Mm-hmm. And then I went to, you know, doing kind of sort of more like rock, but Tahoe is influenced by Bay Area music. So that's what I grew up with. And I just went back. I did a 360 and went back from where I started.
Yeah, that's what I thought as well. I was going to ask you about that because you are from California. Yeah. And that's where G-Funk era grew up back in the, what was it, mid-90s, early 90s kind mm-hmm. of era?
Exactly, yeah.
What kind of keeps you to keep doing that as opposed to moving on to something that's more contemporary?
Because I'm just doing what I like.
Yeah.
That's what I like. I still listen to it. I don't listen, like when I'm listening to Pandora, I always put on, you know, Warren G mm-hmm. or, you know, some old school stuff, you know, Mac Mall, Corrupt.
Yeah.
All that, so.
And how does Skaters and Gangsters fit into that?
So how that started was I wanted to bring the community together. So another friend from Lake Tahoe moved up here. He's B3 the Shark, mm-hmm. and he's part of Battle Axe Warriors, which is Mad Child. And I wanted to create something kind of like that brings the community together, different MCs. They're all doing their own thing, but they're repping the same thing.
Sure.
And so about 2 years ago, I put on a few shows where I brought the community together. I did a concert at the Crocodile, did a concert at Numos.
Huge.
It was like 15 artists. I DJ'd the whole thing.
Wow.
And each artist did about 3 songs. But what I wanted to do is bring it together because that's what the Bay Area does.
Yeah.
Everybody's connected. And I feel like it's a little bit different up here.
Totally.
And so that's why I wanted to bring that same vibe, that same feeling, like kind of like family, you know?
Yeah.
So.
Well, I totally feel that. I mean, that's the main reason I started this podcast was because I see that networking and getting a whole group of hip hop heads in the same area just mm-hmm. to have a good time, it's difficult.
Yeah.
It's not a lot of people are going out to shows. Not a lot of people are supporting each other as much as you think they would be.
Yeah.
Because it is a dope scene out here. Don't get me wrong. I love the music.
There's a lot going on though. That's why. Mm-hmm. There's just so many different things going on that.
Yeah.
And everybody's trying to be in, you know, do their own thing.
Yeah.
So. But it's different. Like if you, you know, look into the Bay Area music, everybody's connected. Mm-hmm. It's like really tight. It's different.
Why do you think that is?
Everybody's trying to hustle, but they're not trying to do it individually. They're trying to do it together. That's what I believe. But I'm actually going to be working in the Bay with Andre Nikatina mm-hmm. and working on my next album. So
great. And I wanted to actually talk to you about you did a cut with Andre Nikatina on your most recent album, Mind of My Business, the Hot Wing Session, right?
Yes.
And that was one of your lead singles from the album, correct?
Yes.
Tell me about working with him on that.
Yeah. So actually how it worked out is that song first started with Rappin' Forte. I'm not sure if you're familiar with him. He's Players Club. He's from Fillmore, San Francisco.
Okay.
And I had a show down in Lake Tahoe and I did a song with him and he wasn't able to do it. But I was opening up for Andre Nikatina. Mm-hmm. And so after Nikatina got done with his set, I walked up to him. I said, hey, can we talk some business? Mm-hmm. I need you to write, record the audio, and record the video all in one day tomorrow.
Wow.
And that's a lot to do.
Right? Yeah.
And so, you know, I had to, you know, pay the price. And he came through. And after that, he liked how I worked. He said, there's not that many people like you that come through that are on top. Like actually about what you say and actually have money to put down.
Mm-hmm. A businessman.
And yeah, and he respected that. So he put me on 2 mini tours, one through Oregon and another one from Seattle all the way down to San Diego. Mm-hmm. And then we ended up doing a new single called Fat Ass. And he flew me down to LA, we did a video for that.
Nice.
And then he put me on a song with Neff the Pharaoh, which is from the Bay, we did mm-hmm. Chocolate Cake. He flew me to San Jose, we did a video for that.
Wow.
And so, He's helping me a lot. He's pushing me a lot, so.
Yeah. What do you think is like the one thing you didn't expect to learn from Andre Nikatina that you have learned since you started working on him on the tracks you've done and then on the tours as well?
Well, you know, it's like doing music for a while and actually in anything, you got to kind of lose the expectation and just kind of go with it and do your best. So I didn't have expectations going into it. I was just surprised that he even wants to work with me. Mm-hmm. And so I just keep doing it, keep pushing it and it's working. So
yeah. Well, because you grew up from a family of musicians, that's right.
Yeah.
Okay.
Now, yeah. I'm not close with, you know, because, you know, so they passed away, but
okay.
But it's in my DNA.
But
my
it's blood. In your DNA. Yeah, you have ancestries in jazz musicians.
Yeah, exactly.
Saxophone as well, I think. Okay.
Boston Quartet, all wow. that. Yeah.
How did that play? How does that play into your music nowadays? Is that something you follow, or is that just something you feel that's ingrained when you're working?
It's more of a feeling, but I don't really think about it too much. It's like a natural feeling. It just comes.
Because I was reading your bio as well, and you said that you're a composer, you do scoring and production.
Yeah, so I was tapping into that, but now I leave it to the professionals.
Yeah.
So I just rap.
Yeah.
I don't make the beats. I don't record myself. I work with D-Sane in Lake City.
Right, right.
And he's huge here. You know, he's worked with a lot of people.
So,
he's helped me a lot. Pretty much I go to school every time I go to in the booth with him. Every time I go to the studio, he lets me know what's up.
Yeah.
He won't just press record. He'll listen to every word that you say. And if you don't say it on point, then it's like, all right, all over again.
Yeah.
So.
Is that the first time you got that from a producer when you're working with them?
Yeah, exactly. Because usually it's, you know, they kick back, boom, I'm getting paid, I'm on the hour.
Right.
And it's like, okay, that's your best. All right, next track, that's the best. All right, cool.
Yeah. So you kind of recognize the importance of not just an engineer,
but
a producer who's coaching you from behind the booth.
Exactly. Yeah, that's exactly what D-Sane's done for me.
Yeah.
Along with Rock Fizzle, who produced all the beats on that Mind of My Business album.
Okay.
Yeah.
Is he mostly doing G-Funk, or did you ask him, like...
Yeah,
you,
no, that's what he's all about.
Wow.
Yeah, so he comes from, you know, his father's in a Lakeside. I don't know if you heard of Lakeside, a 70s funk band.
Mm-hmm.
His dad plays the bass for that.
Wow.
And so, like, he's got funk in him, right? And so I give him an idea, or he'll give me an idea. He'll come up, he'll compose the beat, and then we'll go from there.
Wow.
But he also coaches me, too, so... So I'm, there's a reason why I'm speaker child. I'm just learning, you know what I mean? Honestly. And I'm not like one of those dudes that are like, oh, I'm the best. It's like, I'm open to learn. You know what I mean? So like,
yeah. Where did that name come from anyway?
What's that? Speaker child?
Speaker child. Yes.
It's like I said, I'm just a child. You know what I mean? I'm learning. So
did you have that name when you were in Continental Soldiers as well?
No.
Now this was like totally after that. You came up with this own solo act.
Yeah.
You know, you've worked with Jay Battle a couple times. That's
yeah,
right.
Yeah. He produced to the he did Mexican Neighbors and Letter to My Sister.
Right. And I love that track, Letter to My Sister.
Yeah, which is on YouTube. There's a video for that.
I watched that video. Yeah, it was it was really good. Jay Battle was the guy who was his last episode was on this podcast.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
So I had him here last
week.
He's
a nice guy.
He's super nice.
And he knows what he's doing, and he hustles, and he does music for a living, you know, and he's doing really well for himself. So a lot of respect to Jay Battle. Creeps.
Creeps.
Yeah.
DJ. But as for writing as your artistry right now, you're just rapping.
Yeah, that's it.
Yeah.
Yeah. So just keep it simple, you know?
Yeah.
Keep it simple, stupid.
What is that? What is that? You have the Kiss rule. What does that look like from you? When you're writing a track, are you just feeling out the beat, or you got something in mind beforehand, like when you're writing a song? Are you a songwriter, would you say? Or
so for my debut album, Mind of My Business, I went on a 2-month backpack trip in Europe just by myself. And I really wanted to write when I was there visiting different countries. But I just had ideas in my head. And then I came back to Seattle, and then I went back home, and I just kind of took in like my childhood. And then my first song was Mexican Neighbors.
Landed on the bumpy pavement, lucky. Scrubby born in Chucky. Scraped knees, torn jeans from the box left me bloody. Kick rocks, no money, finding refrost is so funny. Skateboard past dark, today is lovely. Drinking beers, stealing golf carts, running from cop cars, raised with no skate parks. Truth or dare, that's what sets us apart. Raised in a trailer park, 6-pack, shoulder tap, I'm having a blast. Memories happen fast, so I'm making them last. Taking you back, way back, before you had that hat to match. I ain't go seek, is where it's at. The only white homie in the pack. Nike Cortez, sneaker, canica, y loteria. Kids can get a tequila. No rider bikes and Adidas. Now open that back hatch and get those speakers slapping. I'm skating like a king while I'm laughing. Follow the leader, I call it double dragon. There's no time limit, it just happened. 86 for kicking it, are you kidding? I'm a customer too.
Okay, the second beer we're gonna try with Speaker Chat is Hell's Bells, also from Ninkasi. It is 5.3% Hell's Lager, super low IBU at 28 IBU, and it's a Munich style beer.
Munich.
And I was gonna ask actually though, as I pour this, you said you went to Europe.
Yeah.
Did you go there?
I was in Munich. Yeah.
So what's the beer like in Europe? Is it better than American beer? Because I hear it is, and I hear it isn't.
In Europe or just Germany?
Germany. Let's say Germany, and then all of Europe.
in Germany and all of Europe way better.
Really?
Yeah.
I just had a friend who came back from London, and he said the beer there was like, meh.
Oh, okay.
So I don't know, but I mean.
Yeah, I was in Croatia, and I had this beer that was 16.5%.
Yeah, that'll get you fucked up quick, man. Well, hey, cheers to that.
All right.
To alcohol, the cause of and solution to all of life's problems.
What do you think?
Yeah, this one's a little lighter.
Yeah, it's definitely lighter. It's definitely a lager. I honestly don't know how to describe it. I think lagers are kind of boring sometimes.
It's a little sweet.
Yeah, okay, it's a little sweet. I can taste that as well. It's a really cool bottle design, though. We got these doves flying on and these bells. Definitely a nod to AC/DC.
Yeah.
Speaking of artwork, I want to talk about your artwork for your new album, Mind of My Business. By the way, I want to thank you for bringing me all this swag. To everyone listening right here, he brought me just some stickers. He brought me a Hot Wing Session t-shirt, which was his single, and his album in actual physical format. I was going to say I'm going to pop this into my car probably tomorrow when I go pick up some more beer for the next podcast.
And the Hot Wing shirt comes with the song too. It's attached to the tag. Yeah.
When you open it up. Okay. Awesome. Yeah. I'll check that out later. Well, thank you, man. I really appreciate that. That's super generous of you. But back to what I was saying, where did this come? It's a shoebox.
Yeah.
And it's just
shoebox full of cash.
Full of cash. And you also got the Skaters and Gangsters logo on that.
Exactly.
Where did that come from? Not the logo of the Skaters and Gangsters.
So it's late. I put all I have into it. All my money into it. So it's like I'm saving up all my money. And this is all my money.
Yeah.
That I make. I got my mind on my business.
Mind on my business. Okay. That makes I get that. That's clever.
Yeah.
And that's also like I was super impressed by how professional and crisp and well written this new album was.
Thank you.
And you mentioned in the last segment that you went back to your roots of G-Funk and what you grew up on when you started writing these songs. But how did the production take place? How did you find your producer you were mentioning earlier? And
everything's through D-Sane.
Yeah.
So D-Sane introduced me to Rock Fizzle.
Okay.
D-Sane also introduced me to a lot of guests that are on the album.
Okay.
Twin G, Fatal Luciano.
Yes.
Moya Bree, Fees the Germ.
Right.
So
I'm sorry, repeat again. Who was the producer on this?
I'm considered the producer.
Okay, okay. You're the
producer.
So
a lot of
sorry.
People think just because someone makes the beats, they're the producer.
Right.
It's who puts the songs together. Okay. The ideas, the topics, the, you know, like the structure.
Yeah. So,
but it's a collective though. Cause I don't really want to take I did everything.
Right. But it is your album and it's your vision.
Yeah. Exactly. Yeah. So I would,
So walk me through, what was this like as you acting as a producer, executive producer on this album?
Mm-hmm.
You would find would these beats be curated for you and then you'd pick and choose out of them?
No, the beats weren't in the vault and I just picked out of it. Okay, I want that beat. I like that. It was, hey, I want this. I want that.
Yeah.
And I worked with Jay Battle, Creeps.
Uh-huh. Yep.
And I told him, hey, I kind of like this tempo. I want some like orchestra. I want some, you know, old school feel, you know, like, and then we just work it together.
Mm-hmm.
But with Jay Battle, I did that in the studio with him. He'd make it on the spot.
Yeah.
And when I'm working with Rock Fizzle, I give him an idea. He'd let it marinate, work on it. He'd send me a sample and be like, oh, that's the one.
Yeah.
So everybody that I've been working with is so talented. I feel so lucky that I'm able to work with so many talented people.
Yeah.
It's like I have all these tools and they're all really good.
Uh-huh.
So.
And I wanted to ask about this album's release. I noticed on your Bandcamp, it said it was released in 2016, but you just had your album release party last month.
Yeah, so it was completed.
Okay.
But then it wasn't mixed and mastered.
Oh.
And it wasn't released online.
Okay, so you did more of an official release.
Exactly.
Okay.
I just completed it. Because you want to, I feel like I want to, some of the listeners to be able to have something to listen to.
Yeah.
Other than just dropping something like, oh, this is boom. So it's like, they're kind of familiar. Oh, I've heard that song. Okay.
Yeah.
So when it comes out, I have a little bit of following because I'm brand new. Uh-huh. Speaker Child, no one knows.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah. And you do have a bit of a following though. I was looking on your Facebook page and people love the stuff you're putting out. I mean, they like you, man.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. And you know how to run that social game. You post these things and you posted about the podcast before. You're smart about it.
Yeah.
I respect that. But another thing that I respect about you is the lyrics that I was listening to, because I'll be honest, I don't listen to a lot of G-Funk.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, that's not the era I was really raised in,
mm-hmm.
but I can definitely appreciate it. And there's also, you know, I do know the classics who made it.
You
know?
Yeah, yeah.
But I love your hook on the song G-Funk that says, call me old-fashioned. Nah, I just keep it classic.
Yeah.
I really like that line, and I fucking laughed out loud when you said on Hate Me Later, don't be ashamed if you queef.
Yeah.
What the fuck? What is that in relation to, man?
it's pretty much so... It could be taken different ways, but it was like, at first it was, you know, like kind of like a joke, like, oh, I'm for women's rights. Like, it's okay. Don't be ashamed. Like, mm-hmm. because some women are ashamed if they queef. I'm just letting them know it's okay.
It's a perfectly bodily function. It happens.
Exactly. So yeah. Don't be embarrassed.
I mean, guys fart sometimes. Girls queef. It's all good, man. Yeah. But yeah, no, I was listening to it.
That song's just clowning though. It's yeah. like, I got rapping forte on there. It's just like, but really what the song's about is that like, you know, it seems like all the time, it's like nice guys finish last. So it's like, oh, you might as well just be an asshole. Yeah. That's kind of the song, but it's a joke. You know, it's like, you're just playing. It's like every time I'm nice, I finish last. Time to think twice. So I'm grabbing that ass with class.
Yeah. And you know, that's also something that, you know, did you take that away from G-Funk? Because back then they did have a lot of lines like that.
Yeah.
And it is funny.
Yeah.
But it's also just about having a good time.
Exactly. Yeah.
And that's what
not too serious. It's all good. You know what I mean?
And that's what I was vibing with the whole time when I was listening to your album all the way through. I was just like, you know what? This puts a smile on my face. It's not the kind of stuff I usually listen to, like I'll say again, but still, like it's solid music.
Yeah.
Did you write the hooks on this track too? I mean, all the tracks?
Actually, I wrote all the hooks except for Mobbin' Since Monday.
Okay.
Fees the Germ wrote that one.
Yeah, yeah. Okay. And as far as the singing and the melodies that go over some of your hooks, because I noticed they were like, a lot of them were half and half. It'd be you doing the hook and then you'd have like a female lead.
Yeah, that's Moya Bree. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, exactly. I wrote the melodies for that.
Oh, wow.
But then she came in with her own, you know, style that added to it, that took it to the next level.
Yeah.
So
how does that look like when you're working with the singer? Are you kind of humming it out or trying to sing it yourself?
That's all it was. Cause yeah. I can't sing it.
Sure.
Because I can't hit keys. That's why I'm rapping.
Yeah,
but I can hum it, you know, and just be, oh, this is how I want it. And then she'll come in with, you know, powerhouse vocals. Be like, that's it. Bam.
That's great.
Yeah.
And cause like I said before, it was a very cohesive album. And I'm glad you corrected me earlier about that you are the producer, because it shows.
Yeah.
And it's a very, it's a collaborative project, but at the heart of it, yeah. I can tell that it's what you wanted it to sound like.
Yeah, well, there's 19 songs on the album. About half of them have features.
Yeah.
But I'm on every song.
Right,
so
right.
So I kind of wanted to create, you know, Chronic 2001 in a sense, in my own way.
Sure. And you were dropping singles for this thing for like over a year ago, right?
Yeah, this is actually 3 years in the making.
Wow.
Yeah.
So when's the next album going to come out?
So my next project, actually, I'm going to be working with Andre Nikatina, and it's going to be called High on Wheels.
Okay.
And I'm going to be recording in the Bay Area, and that's going to be starting here pretty soon.
Wow.
And he's just going to put me in the booth, and I just have to write it all, bam, right there, get it done. It's no 3 years. I don't got time like that.
Right. Well, you know, they say you have your whole life to make your first album and then you have a year to make your next one.
Yeah. My next one is going to be about 2 weeks.
Wow.
So, yeah.
And so you're just going to be two weeks straight.
I'm already writing though. So good. I'm good. Yeah.
And when you say it's with Andre Nikatina, is he producing it?
He's producing it. He's giving me all the beats. He's giving me all the topics. All that. I'm writing it, but he's giving me the topic.
Yeah.
So.
Is this going to be a California major release then, or are you going to come back to Seattle to kind of debut it?
It's going to be both.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You're going to start touring around some more.
Yeah, exactly.
Because you've been on a lot of tours as well, too. Just with Nikatina.
Yeah.
What was like probably your favorite experience being on the road?
There's a couple.
Hit me.
So one was I played an all-ages show at Eugene at the Wow Hall, and there was a 12-year-old kid there, and it was his first concert ever. And I was doing G-Funk, give the speaker a bump. And it's pretty easy, so it's like kind of crowd participation. So I passed him the mic. He's singing along with it. After my set, I went to my merch table, and he came out, and he's like, this is my first concert ever. And like, he was so happy. And you know, I gave him all my merch, signed a CD, and like, he was thrilled. So yeah. That was really cool.
Wow.
Because you never forget your first concert, so.
What was yours?
It was the Aerosmith, actually.
That's dope. Dude, I mean, that's cooler than mine. My first concert, my sister's older than me, so I was like probably 4 years old. I went to Hanson.
Okay. All right.
Back when I was on that little butt. Yeah.
But so, yeah, so that was cool.
Aerosmith is a bit cooler than that.
And then I also got to sign my first t-shirt for this girl, which she was wearing while I signed it.
Oh, nice.
And then we did a show in Humboldt, and that was a lot of fun.
Yeah.
It was like everybody was throwing weed on the stage. I've never seen this before.
Yeah.
And then when I got off stage, everybody's giving me weed. And by the end of the night, I had an ounce.
It's like, I'm weed rich.
Yeah. But everybody was really cool there.
Yeah.
So it was fun.
Well,
was
I guess
fun.
That's when you're on stage with Andre Nikatina.
We played at a strip club, too.
Nice.
Yeah, it was at a strip club. That's so that was my first experience performing at a strip club.
Yeah.
So that was fun.
Man.
But every show has been fun with Nikatina because he brings out a lot of different people and everybody's, you know, into it. But sometimes it gets tough because I always go on right before him, mm-hmm. and everybody's waiting to hear the headliner. Maybe they've been waiting for 4 hours. And so before I go on stage, everybody's chanting his name.
Oof.
And then I walk up there.
And they're like, ugh.
And I'm like, I'm not Nikatina. I'm a speaker child. And then I go into it. And I just have fun, you know?
Right.
And then by the end of my set, people are feeling it. You know, some people got their arms crossed because they're waiting for Nikatina. Yeah. That's all good. But it's fun every single time. I'm playing with him again September 17th at Studio 7.
Oh, I just had a show there last night.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
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 September 16th. I performed with Nikatina last time he was here a few months ago.
Okay.
So every time he plays up here, I play with him. So I'm his artist.
To see you doing something with Andre Nikatina, I mean, you guys obviously have a good chemistry going.
Yeah. He just got me a distribution deal with Empire out of San Francisco.
Oh, right
so,
on.
Yeah.
So it sounds like,
And now I'm on Pandora, you know, so it's like, that's crazy to me.
Yeah. Because you've been at it for a while, haven't you?
Yeah. I've been doing music since I was, you know, since I could remember.
Yeah. So. Did you always do hip hop or were you like something earlier than that?
No, like at first, you know, my mom always put me in like talent shows when I was really young. And my brother was really into rock, like classic rock. And, you know, he was playing the guitar. I didn't have a drum set, so I just playing 5 gallon buckets.
Uh-huh.
That's my drum set. And then eventually got a little drum set from the thrift store. And I was in this little rock band with my older brother. And we played a show. First show I ever played was, I was 12 years old in a little coffee shop with him. But yeah, so I went from rock to hip hop, back to rock to G-Funk.
Wow.
Yeah.
Can we expect G-Funk in the future from Speaker Child?
Absolutely. That's it. That's all I'm doing.
Yo, I packed a punch. You know, I packed my lunch. I'm talking about that hot wing for every pot. Tea, I'm having a party. You must have heard of us. Skaters and the gangsters. On the verge of a bus.
Ain't no reason I'm just doing it because we're getting ready about to head up to the club. Before the night is over, I'll be full of fun. I'm off that smoke, I'm off that drink. They're telling me to stop and I don't know if I can. Have a bottle in my hand.
Our third and final beer today with Speaker Child is a seasonal release. It's the Ninkasi Oktoberfest, which is a traditional German-style beer. It's at 5.5% and 40 IBUs. You weren't actually in Europe for Oktoberfest, were you?
No.
Man, my roommate, he went a couple years ago. He said it was the most fun he's ever had in his entire life. And man, do you go out clubbing much or do you party much?
Here in Seattle, not too much. I just work and do music. And every once in a while, I'll go out when I have a show.
I mean, hey, you've been at it for a while. You've probably seen everything there is to see about it. But hey, cheers, man.
Cheers.
Let's get some beer in you and then it's right to bed.
Woohoo! Beer, 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 bed, bed, bed.
I like that. I think I like that better than the Hell's Bells and before. It's still just as light, but I like it. What do you think?
It's really good. I like this one a lot.
Yeah, man.
It's probably my favorite so far.
I think, yeah.
Which one is this? Oktoberfest?
This is the Oktoberfest. I mean, I'm an IPA guy myself, so that's probably my favorite. But you're saying the Oktoberfest is your favorite because I was going to ask you next.
Yeah, so far.
Yeah, this is really tasty, man. I'll have you take some home after the podcast.
Nice.
I also want to ask you about something that we didn't get a chance to talk about last time. So
Eugene. Nikasi is out of Eugene?
Right, yeah.
Oh, okay, I love Eugene.
Yeah.
Eugene's shown me a lot of love. I've played there twice with Nikatina.
Yeah.
And every time I go there, it's like I get more and more people that coming out and you know, they keep asking me to come back. So Eugene's a really good spot to play.
I've heard Eugene is just an awesome town.
Yeah, they have a lot of love there.
One thing I forgot to ask you about when we talked about your album art last time was actually all the art that you put out for your brand and your music. I'm looking at the t-shirt you're wearing right now. And
Verge of a Buzz.
There you go. And then also the Hot Wing Session on the t-shirt you gave me.
Yes.
Where does all this art come from, man? Talk to me about
it. So Verge of a Buzz came from Rob Castro, Concuss. He's out of Seattle, and he's also part of Old Dominion, which is pretty big at Seattle. The album art of Mind of My Business and the artwork for Hot Wing Session came from this guy named Noyze, N-O-Y-Z-E, from out of Las Vegas.
Okay.
Yeah.
And what about the hat you're repping right now?
This is Fresh Air. This is out of Lake Tahoe. This is actually my clothing sponsor.
So, okay.
Yeah, they hook me up all the time.
Yeah.
So
where can, if for everyone who's listening, where can they get your merchandise? On your website?
Not yet. No.
Okay.
No, but if they want to get Fresh Air, you go to freshairclothing.com.
Okay.
They got a lot of good gear.
Nice. So, well, I love it.
If you want to get my gear, it's just at my shows.
Come out to the shows, yeah. Yo.
Exactly.
Support local artists, man. It's good music. We're going to transition here to a little game I like to call Flip the Record. Here's how the rules are worked.
Okay.
Flip the Record is a simple game meant to give our listeners a glimpse on your thoughts and opinions on not just hip hop and beer, but really anything that might be fun to know. It's pretty simple. I'll give you two options, and you just name the option you prefer.
All right.
Sound easy enough?
Okay.
Okay. PBR or Rainier?
Rainier.
Okay.
For sure, Rainier.
Yeah?
Yeah.
You have a strong opinion about that.
I don't like PBR, but I don't really like Rainier, but I like Rainier better.
Well, that's the question. It's like they're the cheap beers that a lot of Seattleites drink.
Yeah, you know? I would rather have a Rainier. Okay, for sure.
That's fair.
But I'd rather have Olympia, actually.
Oh, you and my friend Devin would get along. He buys all
it's
that stuff.
It's in the water.
Yeah, exactly. Okay, bass drum or bass guitar?
Man, that's really hard.
I know.
But I would say bass guitar.
I thought you would, because I mean, I just know.
I'd rather have bass driven, something that gets a melody that gets stuck in your head that's unforgettable.
Yeah. Well, and that's a huge, I mean, obviously you can't have hip hop without a bass drum.
Yeah.
But I mean, as far as G-Funk goes.
But you can't have it without a bass guitar.
Right.
Either.
And you got to fill in that.
So I was reading this book about like improvising jazz music, and they asked like, if you only can play with a bass player or a drummer, what would you choose? And the majority of people say a bass player.
Really?
Yeah, no drums, just bass. If there was one or the other. It makes sense to me.
Yeah. I mean, I can see that. I mean, it's more
you're pretty much, you got the rhythm on it. You're still got that.
That's true.
But you also have more melody.
Yeah.
So.
Fair enough. Mac or PC?
Mac.
Snoop Dogg or Dr. Dre?
Damn, in which way?
Define it your own way, man. And you can explain your own opinion on this.
Okay.
And you can even go both sides.
Well, I would say Dr. Dre producing, okay. You know, it's as a rapper, like MC, 16s and all that. Snoop Dogg for sure.
Something.
But like, I don't know. That's still hard to say though, man, because Dr. Dre is pretty good. I don't know.
Hey, man.
Split decision. But if I had to say it.
Everyone knows this is a hard.
If I had to say it, I would say it right now. Dr. Dre.
Yeah. Freestyling or writing?
Writing.
Yeah. Do you freestyle much?
Not much.
Yeah.
But you know, I was watching this little thing on DMX. He was saying he doesn't care what you got to do in freestyle because you're just making it up. You're not really putting all you got into it.
That's true.
It's not well thought out. You could say whatever you want. You could talk whatever you want to talk. But some people are so damn good at freestyling that they're actually meaning what they're saying.
Yeah.
But most people are just trying to rhyme or trying to get through the next line. You know? Not really like saying something real. Yeah.
Every time I've asked someone that on the podcast, they say writing. And as they should. I mean, if there's a rapper, you're more than a freestyler.
Yeah. Which I'm actually tapping into more freestyle. I'm actually trying to work on that more because, like I said, I'm going to be in the studio here pretty soon, and I got to write a lot. And I'm going to hear beats that I never heard, and I have to write hooks on the spot. So
yeah.
And I've been working on that, doing lessons with my friend B3 the Shark. Mm-hmm. We'll just go there. He'll make a beat, and I'll just write and record right then and there. Bam, bam.
Yeah. It's hard to write fast.
Yeah.
Yeah. Speaking of writing with a pen and a pad or on your phone?
I would say pen and a pad, yeah, for sure. I don't write on my phone, I write on my laptop.
Okay.
But sometimes when you're writing with a pen and pad, it's endless and you could just keep writing. You're not deleting things. You know, you might cross it out or like make an arrow here and there.
Mm-hmm.
I feel like it's easier to come up with rough draft. And I would say rough draft, pen and pad, and then final draft, a laptop or cell phone.
Here's a hard one. Hot dog on a hamburger bun or hamburger on a hot dog bun?
Hamburger.
Hamburger bun or hamburger meat?
Wait, hot dog on a hamburger bun.
Or hamburger. Or hamburger on a hot dog bun.
I'd say hamburger on a hot dog bun.
Okay.
Yeah.
You got through that pretty easily. Most people get stuck in a perpetual state of panic during that one.
You know, so I don't really know what's made in that hot dog.
That's true. On one hand, you know that a hamburger is all beef.
Yeah.
And a hot dog, I'm pretty sure, has some raccoon in it.
Or whatever, yeah.
All right, fame or money?
I would say fame, because fame could last longer than money. But I don't know, though. That's hard to say, because you could die out, like, especially in the entertainment industry or rapping or music. You only got a certain amount of years unless you're, you know, huge.
Right.
But I guess it depends how much fame and how much money. To the full extreme, I'd say money.
Yeah, there you go. You can live off money. You can't live off fame.
Yeah.
All right, Washington or California?
California.
Boo! It's about the Northwest.
I like it up here. You know, there's a lot of opportunity. I feel like it's like a open field of opportunity. The economy's really good. Uh-huh. It's easy to make money.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah, how do you make your money?
I actually am self-employed.
Oh, yeah? What do you do?
So I work in Mercer Island.
Okay.
And I have my own, I'm a painting contractor.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
House painting?
Yeah.
Very cool, yeah, man. I did house painting once before I started working for real money. And I shouldn't say for real money. I said for things that I was actually good at. And I was so bad at it.
Yeah.
I was working for like a friend of a friend. And it was my first time painting. And I got paid, but he was like so passive aggressive. He's like, yeah, I'm going to pay you, but I had to redo everything you did.
Yeah, yeah. I just work solo though, just me.
Yeah.
By myself. I'll do whole houses by myself.
Yeah. What do you like listen to? Are you listening to music, podcasts, anything?
Nothing.
Nothing.
I just focus on getting it done. Bam, bam, bam. Gotta go.
Damn.
Yep.
That's how I'm able
to put all that money into music.
Yeah.
So it's like, I don't spend it on anything else. I just take all the money I make and I put it into music.
That's passion, man.
Yeah.
Not a lot of people realize how much money has to go into a record being created.
Well, in a sense, like some people say I'm a rarity, because a lot of rappers, they don't have money unless they're a pimp or they're a drug dealer or they got money given to them from an investor or family member.
Sure.
But I make all my money on my own, so.
Yeah. Are you living out? No, you're living out in Seward Park.
Seward Park, yeah.
Yeah, not Mercer Island.
Right. Yeah, no, it's parallel, though. I could take a kayak across the water right there.
Man, no, that'd be probably better than Seattle traffic. But speaking of Seattle and the area, what are your views on the scene right now? I mean, you've said before that there's not much of a communal aspect, at least when you compare it to the Bay Area. But you're still out there performing, you're grinding, you're meeting up with all these different people. Mm-hmm. What can you say about the scene and what's your opinion on it?
You know, it's interesting because I moved here 6 years ago. And when I first moved here, the scene was huge. Macklemore wasn't even big, but he was big here.
Yeah.
And he was playing, you know, every other month or hosting a show for Grinch or doing this or that. There's a lot of artists that could sell out 200 to 300 people any night, especially Mad Rat, Fresh Espresso, Champagne, list goes on. And a lot of them, I feel like, are doing it like that. And a lot of them quit, you know what I mean?
Yep,
there's no more Mad Rat, there's no more Champagne, like.
Bummer.
And the thing is, it's like, right now, who's really doing it big in Seattle? I don't know, maybe Ryan Carveo? I'm not sure. But everybody's doing their own little thing, you know what I mean? It's not like a collective, but a lot of people would be like, I'm not going to give you a handout. Like, you got to do it your own. You know what I mean? So it's just personal. Like, I guess, however you want to rock, you know? So
how do you as an artist, contribute to the scene from your own opinion?
I don't really contribute much to Seattle hip hop scene, other than the fact that a lot of people say that I hustle. They appreciate my grind. They've never seen someone like me push as hard. And they don't know anyone else that does it like I do.
Mm-hmm.
Because that's all I do. That's all I focus on. You know what I mean? So I guess what I contribute to is giving inspiration by hustling and showing that you could do it on your own.
Yeah.
So it's not like I'm like killing it up in Seattle. You know? So it's like, it's going to take me a long time.
Yeah.
So
We've talked a lot about how on your latest album, again, everyone, it's called Mind on My Business, mm-hmm. How you go back to your childhood and put everything and you take everything from your G-Funk inspiration into it. But is there anything that's current in the hip-hop world outside of Seattle, even anywhere, that you're listening to and you're vibing on?
Neff the Pharaoh.
Neff the Pharaoh?
Yep.
That's it?
A lot of it, you know.
Which is fine, by the way. You don't have to come up with anything else.
You know, I listen to older music. And I would say Neff the Pharaoh is the only dude that I'm really vibing with that's, you know, up and coming.
Yeah.
Mozzie is another one, so.
How's that spelled?
M-O-Z-Z-Y.
Okay.
Yeah.
For everyone who's listening out here, you're a self-made man in this area. You know, you started in California, you moved up to Seattle, you made your own name, you paid for your own album, you work in your own business. For everyone who's up and coming, creating a business as a rapper in the town, what's a piece of advice you could give them trying to do what they love?
Okay.
In music.
So you lose hope, have no expectations, but just keep pushing and driving and write the next song. And in the beginning, you're going to write a lot of bad music, but eventually you're going to learn the game. But you have to get some knowledge from someone that's already been there and understands the art of rap. Mm-hmm. But the thing is, it could take over your life because it takes away from personal time and friendships, relationships, and you have to focus on that a lot. So I guess my advice would be you got to hustle as hard as you possibly can.
Yeah. Words of wisdom. I've heard that it's not a race, it's a marathon. Would you agree with that statement?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah, there's no finish line.
Yeah, so. Absolutely.
But it's about the climb, though. So that's what's going to help you drive to the next level.
Yeah. And ladies and gentlemen, take it from a guy who's you know, put his money into his music and now who's working with Andre Nikatina, is going on tours. Speaker Child is laying some wisdom. If you're listening, you're an aspiring artist. He's doing it right. And we're going to conclude the podcast for now. And that wraps about all the time we have today. But before we go, I want to let everyone know that you can check out Speaker Child's album, Mind on My Business, on Spotify, iTunes, and Bandcamp. You can also see him live on September 1st at the High Dive in Fremont. Is there anything else you'd like to add?
Check me out on Pandora.
Pandora.
Yeah,
Pandora,
it's a good station. You know, it's crazy because on Pandora, they have, you know, similar artists. Mm-hmm. And there's like, I don't even know why, but there's Tupac, Snoop Dogg, Dr. Dre, Lil Wayne, Slim Thug. It's crazy. But yeah, the Pandora station is really good. Also, speakerchild.com.
Gotcha, man. Well, thank you so much for coming on the show. I'm glad you enjoyed the beer. Again, this is Ninkasi Brewing. People who are in Eugene, take advantage of the brewing down there. Cheers, my man.
Shout out to Fresh Air Clothing.
Peace. Down that sour, hate and thank me every single hour. No romance, slow dance. No plans, no pants. Straight funk in your trunk. Slam dunk, give you what you love, give it a tug. Grab that ass when I give you a hug. Love is a crazy ass drug. It's never enough, you want the nice guy? Well, I might as well give it a try. I will not lie, friend zone? Hell no, friend's bone.